joining us this evening. We do realize it's the last meeting of the day here, and we stand between you and after parties. But I can't think of better company to do this last fireside than Kati from Rovio and Rich from Excel. So I just start by saying I think anyone close to the game industry is very fond of Rovio as a company that has meant a lot of things, both for Finland and for games. You know, it was certainly the first company to make a global success sort of casual game on smartphones. But also, I think it's a company that embodies the Finnish spirit of sisu, of perseverance, of resilience, of will to win. And it was really the first company that put Finland in the map for many people around the world, other than Nokia, Silver Hills before. And I think I'd like to give the benefit to the audience to hear a little bit of the origin of the company, the story of how did it start, how the first challenges you faced as in the first 6 years built, what is it, 51 games before Angry Birds, and really give us a sense of all the hard work that went in behind the scenes.
Hey, thanks. Great to be here, first of all. And thank you, Rich, as well, joining the short chat that we're having today. Well, Rovio was established in 2003, and that was, as you said, game number 52 that made the huge success that Rovio experienced. And the game was actually launched in December 2009. So we are celebrating the bird day in a few days, and that's going to be 8 years now. So, of course, there was a lot of hard work, a lot of dedication, determination from the team that put together the game. And there were ups and downs already during those years, definitely. But when the success came, it obviously was a huge and kind of like it came in a very short period of time as well. We're in a digital world, so the game was out there very quickly. And also the bird characters that had been created were so, how would I say, one would say lovable and kind of like a little bit mischievous, edgy. And there was a clear sign that these characters can do much more also beyond the games. And after that, there was a different kind of entertainment means that the company stepped in, consumer products. And obviously, one of the big things that started already in the minds of the company at that point of time was the movie. We did certain animations, and it felt like this is a IP and then later on a brand that can create actually a movie as well. And that thinking started in very early days after the launch of the game.
Great. And I'll come right back at this sort of evolution of the IP through different forms of media over time. But Rich, my main question for you when I first saw the relationship between Excel and Rovio was the fact that you're based in California. And I think Helsinki is a bit, was at the time a bit of a remote place. So, compared to today, I'm wondering, what was it that drove you to sort of pursue this investment at the time, jointly with Atomico, and what was it that really captivated you on the company?
Sure. First of all, thanks for having me here. Thank you for moderating the panel and. I've had the chance to see Slush from the very beginning of the first conference, so it's amazing how large this event and this organization has come to. To your specific, question, for all of us that grew up in the mobile industry, Helsinki in Finland was not a distant place. Mm-hmm. Obviously, Nokia, which really created a lot of the modern world of mobile, was of course headquartered here, still is headquartered here. And so a lot of us came here to Helsinki to meet with the partnerships and develop partnerships there. So Helsinki did not feel like an unfamiliar place to me in those days. But the simple reality is, as you know, in gaming, there are companies that only produce one thing and are unable to sustain that over the course of time. And I'd heard the story about I didn't actually realize it was 51 games at the time, but I knew the company had experimented and tried with many things before they got to Angry Birds. And the very fact that they had that sisu, that toughness to keep experimenting, was what very much attracted us, in addition to the incredible brand that Angry Birds had started to become. And then I should, of course, just briefly mention that Peter Vesterbacka, who many of you know, who also helped to create Slush, was a personal and still remains a very close personal friend. And that connection, in addition to the incredible work of the management team, the head family, is why we and Nicholas Zennstrom, who was just up here from Atomico, became investors. We're incredibly grateful to Kati and the rest of the management team, you know, to be part of it.
Great. So going back to the topic of expanding an IP into different ideas and different media formats, when you build Angry Birds, the feeling of a customer really is of that of one of the most recognizable brands in the world today. Do you think that is because of this transmedia approach? What drove the decision making to, you know, pursue merchandising and then later films and different games that have less to do with the slingshot mechanic that made it the first game popular and really make people exposed to the birds in different ways? Our experience with Supercell was a bit on the contrary side, where we focused really on mobile games, not on, you know, movies and other aspects. And I was very interested when I saw the success of the film last year. Mm-hmm. Congratulations on the box office.
Thank you. Well, first of all, you talked about the awareness, and the brand awareness is incredible. It is 97% globally. And that, of course, gives you a lot of benefits. Being in a, or having and owning a brand like Angry Birds is definitely something that you should be exploiting in a wider means than only in mobile games. Although we are a games first entertainment company, we do still have, as you said, merchandising, and we keep on having them. With regards to the movie, we've made a little bit of a different decision according to our current strategy, being games first company. Instead of financing it by ourselves, as we did the first movie, we actually licensed the brand to Sony, and Sony is now producing and distributing the movie. We figured out that this is pretty safe way to continue. Sony was our partner in the first movie as well, and since they have the expertise, the knowledge, that's their core business. So it's better that they focus on that one, and we focus on our core business, which is games. Although, you know, as said, giving the brand in the minds of consumers, it's good to have additional things beyond the games as well.
Great. This is a question for the two of you, and you'll probably take turns answering this. But for those of you who were around a few hours ago, my colleague Martin introduced a sort of new initiative to educate founders into how to reward talent, how to attract talent, how to retain talent over time. And I feel one of the really good things Rovio did, with the success of the brand, was really start importing talent from around the world into Finland and later on in the different hubs that Rovio has opened around the world. At which point did you decide that diversity of talent was important? How did you manage to extend the sisu that the founding team had into the rest of the team, you know, through good times and bad? And make people loyal over time.
It was very, very early on when it was clear that it's good to have different cultures working for the company. We have at the moment approximately 30 different nationalities in Rovio, as well as the diversity from male, female, gender perspective is important as well. I mean, we're making products for both females and males, and I think it is very important to have people who actually are from the both genders to think about the products as well from the development phase already. And like I said, this started very early on. We have approximately 30% of our workforce females. So in that sense, it could be obviously bigger, but we are gradually getting more and more, hopefully, going forward, at least promoting for that as well. Because like I said, I believe diversity is very important for the company as well. And then how to, your second point, how to, the build the culture and extend the sisu to those people who might not be born in Finland. But I'm not saying that sisu or this determination, resilience wouldn't be with others as well. But maybe it's something a little bit more common to Finnish. At least we want to believe so. So it's something that you can only, teach or spread around by your own example. you have to be the one who doesn't give up and bring the energy to the organization and show that this is how we do it. It's not words. It's not a book that you will give somebody or some employee guidelines that this is how we want to be. It's how you act and behave. And it is actually contagious. That's what we realized.
If I could just add to that for a second, I think one of the unique, I think, advantages of coming from a smaller country, a smaller population base, as opposed to, like, say, the U.S. or, say, China, where everybody kind of is, most of the people you talk to are from your own culture, is I think whether you're from Finland, whether you're from Australia, from some of these other smaller population markets, is that you have an understanding and an immediate outward-looking view of other cultures and other nationalities, because inherently you're going to be working across multiple cultures and geographies. And so I think that's why you see in a couple of interesting cases, you know, Atlassian in Australia as an example, obviously here Rovio and Supercell, companies that are creating products that come from some of these small countries have a more natural understanding in some cases of outside their home country because they have to in order to grow, you know, reasonably successfully. And so I think that mentality, that underlying Finnish mentality that started here with Rovio in Helsinki is why it has, I think, such a attractiveness to people of many different backgrounds. And then second, if I could just emphasize this again, you know, without Kati's leadership, we wouldn't be anywhere close to where we are today. I mean, we all know there were some ups and downs along the way to even get to this point. And of course, we'll deal with challenges and issues in the future. And when you look at what the company went through in this last couple of years and the successful place it is now, it's because of the leadership that we have is why we're there, in addition to all the other nice things about culture. So I just want to ensure that that's clear.
And Rich, just to double down on that, you know, you're one of the investors in the Bay Area that has had exposure to, I guess, most distant cultures and places geographically, with your involvement in Atlassian as well as here in Rovio. Do you feel it's added to you as an investor, as a board member, to kind of go a bit out of your comfort zone to search for these pearls and exciting investment opportunities outside?
You know, look, the simple reality is that life is about a combination of experiences that you're lucky enough to have. Of course, we have a day job, as you know. We Index and Excel, Atomico all have the job of making money for our limited partners and for our partners. But, you know, I think, you know, life would be kind of boring if all you did was invest within 30 miles of Palo Alto and in all the same social media and the same software companies. And so for me, I do have a special joy of coming here, of going to Sydney, Australia, of going to Lithuania, and sort of seeing entrepreneurship really develop in markets where maybe 15, 20 years ago, that wasn't expected. Because you hope that you get a chance to leave a imprint that's not just making a bunch of money and having a couple of companies be sold, but to get to touch certain other parts of the world and have an impact beyond that. And so that's why I very much enjoy coming here and spending time with the Rovio team and in other areas that are, in many cases, outside of traditional Silicon Valley.
Maybe just to add that we definitely appreciate that a lot. It's been such a great to see that even though being so far from Palo Alto, we still get you here frequently and can have these chats.
Thank you.
And, you know, as you mentioned, you know, good times, bad times. Could you, you know, for the benefit of the public, in your experience, what was the hardest sort of challenge the company ran into since founding, possibly, or since the investment, whichever? But
yeah, obviously, I've been with the company 5.5 years, so I wasn't there in early days, and I have to give a big credit to the people who have been there and done the job and are still there doing the job as well. Together, we're a team, that's clear. But if we look at 5 years horizon, time horizon, obviously, we had a challenging time when the business model in mobile games changed from premium games to free-to-play, and we had a bit of a catch-up there to do. And to get the team in a right spirit again, believing in themselves, giving the encouragement, and I myself can't do the mobile games. I'm not a coding person. I've admitted that publicly, and I'm adding it again. But it doesn't mean that you couldn't help the team to feel that, hey, we have the belief, we have the talent, we can make this, we'll just push through and we'll learn and we'll get there. And again, there were many other people doing this as well, but that's the team stuff. And to believe what you're doing, having the passion and loving what you're doing will take you there.
And the effort is clearly worthwhile. So, you know, it's interesting to see that you are probably the only or among the few women who are CEOs of not just a gaming company, but also a tech company more broadly. I wish in a few years from now we can see that as a much more widespread phenomenon, but especially not being a founder, but being elected as CEO. When you first, how does the industry perceive that in a way? You know, the ratio of gender diversity you have is fantastic. Mm-hmm. I wish we could say the same about many other companies in games and in other sectors. So mm-hmm. how do you approach, you know, managing the team, growing the team, and keeping that true over time? Mm.
It's always interesting to discuss the ratio female male and different industries, and I have to say that, for example, during the IPO roadshow rounds that we did quite a few, I didn't see many females in the meeting rooms. It was usually only males, few exceptions, I have to say, and it kind of like makes you feel a little bit like, who is not belonging to this group? But then again, you know, you just that's how it is as of today. If we can do something going forward in those sectors as well to get more female, very good. Because I think, again, diversity is a good thing for everyone, also for males.
And 100%.
But then what comes to the teams and building them and growing the teams, I think it doesn't actually... I don't think that there is a very much difference between being a female or a male leader in the sense that it's a lot about your personality and the understanding how you can, you know, make sure that you have right people in the right spots. There can be tons of talents in the company, but if they are not sourced in a right way or, you know, made sure that they have the tools to succeed, it doesn't help. And I think that's one of the things that the leader must understand, regardless of being a male or female, that he or she is there for the people and not the other way around, and making sure that the teams can success. And if that comes, then the whole company will be successful. So I think very simple, but that's how I think about it.
That's great. I think we're about to finish, but I would last... question for me is for the entrepreneurs in the room, would you give them advice, especially the ones in the early days?
I think there is one word, and that's sisu. Exactly. Yeah.
Great. Well, thank you, everyone. It's always wonderful to be here in Helsinki, and especially in such a good company.
Thank you.
Thank you, Guzman. Thank you. If I could just say one last thing to say, hey, congratulations to the Slush team. I remember when this was a relatively small conference at the cable factory, as I remember, and it was no heating and it was cold. There were certainly no lasers. And it's stunning to see how far this has come. So to Peter and all the other people that helped create this over the years, it's just incredible work. Thank you for having us.
Thank you.